Jokes aside, I like the conference, the direction and the mood where it's going. Because in the break we were talking that some other conferences, the topics they have are if something goes wrong, what could go wrong, what to do in a bad project. And here we hear real cases where people have done something well, and also some have been enjoying the stuff they have been doing. So I've been enjoying what I do in telecoms, and now I enjoy helping companies to train them. And actually, agile companies need project management. And project management waterfall-based companies need agile. So I have plenty of job. But the way to look at the agile or waterfall is depending on your point of view very much. Tell me, please, what bees see around them? Ideas? What they see?
Flowers.
Flowers. Blossom. Like in projects. Well taking care teams and people. They see opportunities and rewarding work and maybe salaries or something else. And what flies do? What they see around them? Yes! That's correct word. No, one could say they both are insects. Like, I don't know, waterfall or agile methodologies. Yeah. Flies just see slight PR issues, I think. They need to improve their PR. But the difference is mainly in your viewpoint. Why I'm telling this about flies and bees? When I was young, my grandfather was teaching me to take care of bees, and I became a beekeeper. And I see now, when I am assessor in project management, that and helping to do good project management to companies, is that actually setting up this good standards for project management is the same like taking care of bee families. You take care of project teams, you take care of bee families, and then they are self-organized, actually. But it depends on your viewpoint, how you do it, and depends on the viewpoint from them. In this nice picture, Philip Schroeder have nicely pointed that the linear nature of waterfall model and iterative nature of agile processes. Can you please tell who here counts himself as agile person? Okay. And who counts himself as a waterfall adept? Same people? let's go further. You know that our logical part of the brain on right hand side controls vice versa. Realistic on the left side controls our right hand, and vice versa. Our creative right brain controls our left hand. So this is why people who are left-handed, there is statistics that they are more creative, more artists, and then. But here, who are right-handed? Absolute majority. And left-handed? Good. We have some creative people in IT conference. Fantastic. And now please stop and think. The right-handed ones. Are you really right-handed only? Can I chop your left hand and you will be fine? You just use it for some other purposes. And the Rust studies that show that actually we need the left hand in order to think properly also. If we continue same logic, dividing into left-handed, right-handed, agile, waterfall, then we might end up like in this story by Jonathan Smith about Gulliver Travels, where there were two citizens, big Indians and then the little Indians. One were adamant that you need to start your egg from big and other, no, from little end. And war erupted and thousands died in the Blefuscu village or site. And actually, we see right now, as I'm representative of this old school International Project Management Association and the guys who like the waterfall projects in mega projects, in construction, in other industries, not only in software development. But there is a real clash with the new guys coming and saying, no, we don't need project managers. They are quite dogmatic in saying these things. But actually, I don't want to give any theories. I will share the case where I was project manager, and that the case of telco organization, which is not about software development, which it was about change, organizational change. And in that project, I think we were quite agile, but the environment was waterfall-based. The process of organization. And this is why we constantly run into clash of agile project team trying to follow the values, principles, and to adapt some practices, while the overall organization, the big machine, required following the process and quality measures. But understanding the difference between these three layers, to me, is quite important how to find a way for a project to actually do something. Because if nobody tries in big organizations to adopt agile values and principles, then big organizations will never change. Do you agree? And this organization where I worked, it's shared service center of Tele2. They were in search, white shared services. Organization was in search of model to operate somewhere in between of decentralized model and centralized services. So in Riga, there is on Mokusalas, and some people are from that organization. Who serve like 11 countries where Tele2 does business. And what we did was the project to set up a central service desk, a function, with people, with processes of all countries changing to send all the requests and the incidents to this point in Riga. So that was project that actually worked through many countries, and many countries are different. They grown by acquisitions, so different maturity levels, and each country has own boss that has different vision how things shall be done. So in order to minimize these political tenses, we agreed in the project to start applying the principle of minimum viable product. So there are more than 200 systems that needs to be transferred, and everyone needs to be aligned to one process. But to start with, we don't create just Gantt diagram and plan for all these 200 systems. We need to start from something to prove the concept. So we just used one opportunity that there was a Siebel system rollout coming, and they needed the support anyway. So we just agreed on the napkin, a new process, without any fancy, I don't know, setting new organization, taking people on board. We just made agreement with existing current billing operation structure that we take some people for the period to test this process and function. And this is how it started. Actual department of service desk started several months later, but the test, what was enough for process to work, was done. And that's I think is a recommendation that can be used by any project that wants to be better. And I don't know, better projects is equal agile? Not always. So it feels when I talk to old guys from Project Management Association that they did a lot of these techniques before they were named agile. So they call this doing projects right. So common sense is another name. But this bringing quick wins helps really to build up trust, shut up critics, and gain attention of laggards in the organizational changes. Because then you agree on, like, we did new system change each second week. So each second week we came up with, oh, new system rolled out. So we constantly showed the progress. This is typical approach in telecom organizations and in many big organizations, how planning is done. First of all, we fix the scope up front. And that drives our schedule and cost estimates. And actually, all the managers, they are graduates of business administration schools. What is administration? We take something from one pile, we do something, we put to another side. We administer. That's pity. It's, there are no school of business leadership, I don't know. Could be. But that means that all the management system, as also some guys today have told, are built on this management dogmatic approaches that you need schedules and costs. You need these estimates. So what we had to do, we just flip the triangle, vice versa. So we knew the time when all the systems needs to be transferred. We got the approval of the budget, but the scope we kept flexible all the time. So this is called in scientific literature paradigm shift. So many approaches of project management are based on keeping the scope changes away from the project. And what we did is, like, we said, say yes to project scope changes. And for me as a project manager, that meant following double standards. So actually I had to, in the team, foster the culture of, yeah, let's optimize, let's do like what is better for the business, what brings more value. And I go to steering committee, I say, okay guys, here are the plan, we have change again. I follow the procedure. change again, that's fine, reasoning. So keeping these double standards gives a burden. For example, you need to create not only work breakdown structure, but also backlog in parallel. And but the process of the organization was waterfall-based gate model. So there are specific phases. In each phase, you can have small change. In each phase, that's tricky. That's why big organizations can always say, we don't need to change overall process. You can play your agile. Our process says okay to changes. That's fine. But that's double standard, very much. Because one example, story. I call it orthodox QA. So when I had the moment to approve all the plans and start actual changes, there was a gate. And I did before you go to the steering and present, you need to get review by quality expert who reviews all the documentation, all the planning, etc. And he gave just quite negative feedback. And and I went back and explained that we have approach. This is organizational change project. That's exceptional. We need. Do you imagine a plan of Gantt diagram of 200 systems up front without learning from each transfer? Now you need to follow. And then he gave again negative feedback. So, okay, we tried. We actually, with the team, have started to write additional risk analysis. We increased planning from 80 something points lines to 190 lines, and again. So what I had, I just had to go to steering and draw a 30-70 diagram. You know it? And that's about decision making. And I explained that, you know, guys, when I came first time and asked for go decision, and you, based on quality expert recommendation, sent me back, we were somewhere here. Now we are somewhere here. We got hurt more details, we planned more, but for the quality of the outcome, this changes nothing. We just are burning our time, resources, and that's it. And as far as in that project, they knew that the contract with organization that we will be substituting is terminating, and prolonging the contract will mean plus 1 year and big cost. Then, okay, they said, we are unhappy. You do not succeed with quality criteria pass, but we give go. So then project went into quite easy phase. It was just following system by system, getting the feedback from users of that system, from system admins, and then trying to change what you do differently in transfer of another system. And you just leave the manifesto, leave the values. We have our own interpretations how to do it. But here another story. We value working system software over comprehensive documentation, right? okay, I just created a process in one meeting, and without adding additional efforts to make it nice and shiny in PowerPoint or Visio, I got approval of steering and send it out to countries, and it was in this way also included in knowledge wikis. So why not? There was documentation. This is documentation, but I just didn't spend this, I don't know, extra efforts to make it very formal. Another story is about what we noticed from these small transfers. After one transfer, we noticed that majority of the requests from this new huge system, Sybil, is about account creation, account modifications, and this kind of simple requests. But help desk was not able to deal with that at the moment. And that was not in the scope of the project to make these changes, to implement the account creation function in the service desk. But who cares? We want to bring more value. So we borrowed a tool from testing department that helped to make the process semi-automated. And then the majority of the accounts were created already semi-automatically by the help desk. And admins only needed to create this advanced level right things, because you can delegate, but you need to think what can happen if you delegate root creation. Like another trick, I don't know, that we liked very much was that in the meetings we just agreed that when we go to another meetings, each member just says quickly, "Hi, my name is Vladimir. I work in the project. Which has goal? And one sentence. And that's not about, I don't know, communication, which was important in a big organization to make communication more massive. But it was about creating the team spirit within the project. Another that helped to energize the team was building the identity of the project. This picture I took with my camera, and this is Frank, the guy used in advertisements. This is the dirty cup of one of the team members and the headphones of another, and the old meridian of third person. Each presentation, we started with this slide. It became like visual identity of the project. When we talk about tools that project have been using, we have been using physical Kanban board in the war room. But as far as half of the team was in Sweden, we also had to duplicate things into virtual tool. And this didn't work. Just didn't. The duplication. But another story about using a tool was that for knowledge management, you need some database. And the corporations, they have like big ones, Remedy. And operators, they didn't like the tool. Not at all. So what we noticed, that instead of using this Remedy knowledge management tool, they started their own project, created a wiki. So, okay, we don't push. We analyzed how to bring this wiki to the usage instead of. So from one side, you can say, we had in the scope goal to push this corporate tool forward, and we failed. From another side, we gave to the guys who are really doing the job the tool that is useful for them, usable, and that they are happy to use. About the skill set, when you structure the organization, it's help desk is about helping with technical issues. So one typical move that all organizations do is to choose most technically skilled persons to the team. But as far as this is the face that communicates on behalf of IT, then we went another way. We chose who are able to talk with different users, and then gave them trainings in the technical areas. So customer service skills as a primary, and then giving in trainings in the value stream. And value stream of the incidents, value stream of the requests is going through the service desk. So for this particular organization, it was Lotus Notes that were the most widely used, because many small databases existed and many requests came somehow related to Lotus Notes. So what we just invited one consultant who helped guys to get the knowledge how to resolve this Lotus Notes related issue in the first place without forwarding to second line support. And for the KPI of first call resolution rate, which was the primary measure, that was very good, because these KPIs skyrocketed immediately. But again, it's important that when we have been doing these trainings, is to give to people who work something that is significant, not just analyzing and forwarding to another to solve. Something also new to learn, and something that is doable, not like challenge you sit and do half a day. But by doing this, you build up the trust by other customers of the service desk, and you build up the trust of the personnel who just started in this function, in this job. Pity that I cannot share exact numbers of the improvements. This organization could sue me if I share that is not publicly available. But I can say that time-wise, the typical project, and this was planned for 12 months, it was done completely in 8 months, time-wise. Cost-wise, we scrapped quite many unnecessary activities that were planned in the beginning, and replaced them with more useful. But again, we saved something like 30% of the budget. Scope-wise, we did not what we promised in the beginning, but we did what was really appreciated by the customers. And this guy, who have been quoted already, have said also this, that culture eats strategy for lunch. And this we have learned also in this big organization, that changes take longer than expected. That's first of all, yes. Big culture is big organization culture is not changing in one day. But another thing that we learned was that success of manager is not in his bright idea how to implement Agile correctly in this organization, or how to do right architecture, how to program the system that is really meeting the needs of the customer. But the success is in his ability to find way to implement these ideas in the current organization culture, in the current setup, with all the laggards, with all the powers that keep you away from meeting these goals. And I love very much ITIL and project management and Agile, but I learned that in this organization, in order to implement some principles, you better don't call them by these names. You just say, oh, that's a solution to this problem. And even more effective, if you just drop this idea somewhere in a meeting with in Swedish headquarters and move away. And later you see this coming as a directive and big idea of managers. So that's some sort of tricks. So in general, what worked and what not? So this constantly delivering something, minimum viable product, and the planning via pool where teammates choose what is more important to do at the moment. But passing quality criteria just failed. Frequent deliveries worked well, but scheduling and then estimating them was nightmare. The physical board in the war room worked perfect. The virtual tool, maybe we were not experienced enough to push it, but we struggled. Somehow we also failed to be agile, as some have said, by doing all the techniques exactly how we should, like doing the daily stand-ups. But for example, the time and budget we kept, and we met the requirements, but the scope was changing. Because focus was on value to business and to not overrun the cost and meet the schedule. What was quite difficult was to meet integration needs where other big projects required something and some dependencies on them. Here you can see the difference between pros and cons of waterfall and agile. One and another has them, the pros and cons. And you need to be aware that not in all situations you can just go with agile or just go with waterfall. In the close to the end, I want to quote the guys who wrote very nice things in their Chaos Manifesto, Standish Group. The Standish Group has came to believe that there is no need for large projects, and that any IT project be serious of small projects, and that can be done in parallel if necessary. Ladies and gentlemen, I couldn't agree more. I don't know, to me, this is clear answer how to implement Agile in big organizations, in large projects. I was talking about telecoms. So one can think that Agile and telecoms are oxymorons, that words with opposite meaning, not going together, which is not true. Because there are cases of large telecoms like Ericsson, who did massive transformation of more than 2,000 people organization to Agile. There are another examples of like AT&T in Israel, etc. These two offices, do they have Agile? Some of them, a little bit. People who work there, they are aware, but they struggle as we struggled in this project to get approach in. What I can offer is actually, if you are interested in going to work in this to organizations, just let me know, write to me, and I will send you link to positions. That's the only way to change these big organizations. You just go inside and do what you think will bring them to the Agile side. And do a lot. And have a lot of patience. Thank you very much.